Okay, let's talk about the comments of Justice Secretary Ray Mulia. What do you make of it? I'm sure you've heard that he said that the Lima's lawyers are a bit at fault and should have filed a writ of habeas corpus instead.
Well, he can say whatever he wants to say about the lawyers of Ms. De Lima, but the fact is that all of these things that he's been saying, that Ms. De Lima should have filed a petition for bail based on humanitarian grounds, he wanted to bend her to his will, basically. He wanted Ms. De Lima to accept that, the subtext here is that if she accepted bail based on humanitarian grounds, that the cases that she's facing is weak. And Ms. De Lima has really remained steadfast in her conviction that the cases against her are weak, and that she would want the court to rule on the bail petition based on the merits of this mm-hmm. case. So that is not at all, an unusual position from somebody with a strong conviction such as Ms. De Lima. In fact, instead of ridiculing that position, she should be celebrated for keeping her faith in the due process and in the justice system.
Okay, let's talk about the Muntinlupa Court now. The court has been saying it did not grant the bail petition of Senator De Lima because there is really strong evidence linking De Lima to the drug charges. Do you think this is valid?
Well, it's hard to see it that way, given the fact that two witnesses have recounted their testimony against her. There are three cases, but all of these three cases are similar. Okay. In nature, they're not related. They're not technically they're not related, but they're similar in nature. And we all agree that these cases are part of the campaign to discredit Ms. De Lima, to persecute her. And so, it would be disingenuous of the courts to not consider the previous acquittal of Ms. De Lima. To ignore that. To ignore the fact that the witnesses have recanted, to ignore the fact that Mr. Rafael Ragos himself had said that he was coerced by the then Secretary of Justice Vitaliano Aguirre III to testify falsely mm-hmm. against Ms. De Lima. To ignore that is just, I think, bottom line, it's wrong.
Okay, Carlos, you're saying the three cases, the drug cases against the senator, are similar in nature, and then we get an acquittal for two drug cases, now the remaining third case. Can you expect the same outcome now, given these developments?
Well, we hope certainly that the court will reconsider its position. Keep in mind that this is just one judge giving his ruling on the bail petition, but this is the same judge that will acquit or convict Ms. De Lima down the line. So we hope that the judge will have a change of heart. We hope that he sees the cases against De Lima for what it is, which is, bogus, basically. Mm-hmm. These are trumped-up cases, politically motivated cases. At the end of the day, if the judge sees it that way, we are confident of an acquittal. But, this is where the political will of the Marcos administration should come in. It's not as if they're helpless here. Theoretically speaking, the Department of Justice can ask the prosecutor to petition the court to drop the charges against Ms. De Lima, but they haven't done that. Instead, they have actually doubled down on their persecution of Ms. De Lima. What Mr. Duterte had done against Ms. De Lima since 2017, the Marcos administration is pretty much doing it, continuing it. So this flies in the face of the avowals by Mr. Marcos that human rights reforms are coming under his administration. The international community should not, as I said, should not stand for this. They should denounce this, and they should take this into consideration as they deliberate, for instance, on whether to extend the GSP plus tariff perks of the Philippines under this administration.
Yes, we've heard a lot of reactions, in fact, from the international community about the latest developments in the De Lima case. What is the impact of this development, the denial of that petition, in terms of the country's human rights record in general? Is this a big impact to it?
I think this indicates to the international community, to those who are watching the human rights situation in the Philippines, this indicates to them that things are changing. If ever they're changing very, very slowly in the Philippines, which is actually still a problem because, Mr. Marcos inherited a serious, serious human rights situation in the Philippines from Mr. Duterte. And we expect him, Mr. Marcos, to really, hit the ground running in terms of human rights reforms. Now, with this a denial of bail and the message that it imparts, which is that the court system in the Philippines is still stacked against those who are being politically persecuted. I mean, this should make the international community sit up and notice. And it's time for them to act on the problem in the Philippines.
Meantime, locally, what can human rights advocates do to push this?
Well, protesting, dissenting is still key in all of this. We still need to keep on advocating for the Department of Justice, for the prosecutor, for the courts to be expeditious, but also more importantly, just in handling the case of Ms. De Lima. Her supporters, the human rights movement, the human rights community need to keep showing solidarity to Ms. De Lima and all the victims of human rights abuses in the Philippines. Keep in mind, Stanley, this is not just about her. Ms. De Lima is in jail, is in detention right now. She is being persecuted because she stood up for the human rights violations that are committed by the Duterte administration in the war on drugs. This is larger than Ms. De Lima. So it's very important for the public to support her and to communicate to the government that the days of human rights abuses, the days of political persecution should be over.
All right, Mr. Carlos Conde, Senior Researcher, Human Rights Watch. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you, Stanley.